Après la première session donc sur neurofeedback des neurosciences à la psychiatrie, on va enchaîner sur la session neurofeedback multisignaux. Et donc en premier lieu, on a le plaisir d'accueillir Stéphane Debner. Alors Stéphane Debner, il est psychologue à l'université, il est professeur à l'université d'Oldenburg. Et donc, pour vous résumer un petit peu son parcours, il a obtenu son doctorat à l'université de Dresden en 2001. Il a ensuite fait un postdoc à Hambourg jusqu'en 2005. Il a ensuite été senior clinical scientist à Southampton jusqu'en 2008, puis professeur à l'université de Jena jusqu'en 2009, et enfin professeur à l'université d'Oldenburg depuis 2009. Alors, moi, je suis une grande fan des travaux de Stéphane Debner et j'admire particulièrement le fait que ses axes de recherche couvrent tout le panel de la recherche en neurofeedback, et notamment, il essaye de comprendre vraiment les mécanismes fondamentaux qui sous-tendent le neurofeedback d'un côté, et puis il va jusqu'à la recherche translationnelle, puisqu'il travaille beaucoup sur l'utilisation de neurofeedback et d'interface cerveau-ordinateur à domicile, notamment par les patients qui ont subi un AVC. Donc je vais laisser la parole. Donc Stéphane devra partir juste après sa présentation. Donc ce qu'on vous propose, c'est de faire une présentation interactive. Donc dès que vous avez des questions, n'hésitez pas à vous faire voir et on viendra vous donner le micro. Si jamais vos questions sont en français, il n'y a aucun souci, la présentation va être en anglais, mais n'hésitez pas à poser des questions en français et puis on traduira la question si besoin. Ok, donc je laisse la parole à Stéphane, merci beaucoup.
Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, apologies for not giving this presentation in French. Well, I don't speak much French. Can you hear me? Is this switched on? Okay, perfect. And feel free to interrupt me anytime. I'm really happy to take your questions while presenting. Okay, so the title I got from Fabien, so he's to blame. and now I will try to make sense of this. Okay, and before I give you some background about my current research. So what we are aiming for in a large funded project is a cognitively controlled hearing aid. So we want to use EEG to control hearing aids. One reason is that a hearing impairment is a really kind of a frequent disorder, and in particular in middle age, like many of us are in this age group now, if you want to prevent or at least delay dementia, then treating your even mild moderate hearing loss is really, really important. Okay, so there are large scale reviews supporting this claim. So if you have some hearing loss, do something about it, don't ignore it. Okay, so the modern hearing aids are pretty smart. They can, for instance, solve the cocktail party problem. So with different people speaking simultaneously, the hearing aid could easily, using beamformer technology, increase the gain of one out of several sound sources. But of course, the device is stupid. It doesn't know which listener you want to attend to. And this is exactly what we want to convey with the EEG. So we have a closed loop system. This means, okay, we are trying to collect data that would allow us to decode auditory attention and then feed this information into a hearing aid to just adjust some settings. Now, is this a neurofeedback or a brain-computer interface? Well, that really depends on how you define the field. For me, there's not too much of a difference. So we are closing the loop, okay? And both systems, of course, use near real-time feedback of brain signals, okay? So what real-time means is also quite different for different disciplines. When you talk to auditory scientists, like those developing algorithms for hearing aids, they have to be done with the signal processing within 10 milliseconds. Otherwise, the natural sound you still hear and the amplified sound don't match at all, and the sound experience will be really bad. fMRI, we're happy about like 5 to 10 seconds and so on. So that also needs to be defined what near real time is. Now, in my view, a neurofeedback aims for improving somehow brain function. But of course, in order to do so, you need some form of device giving conveying feedback to the user. Whereas a brain-computer interface, here the aim usually is to just control a device, but it would be outright stupid to consider a brain-computer interface without any learning. And it's not only the machine learning, but it's also the user learning. Okay, so how is this different from a neurofeedback application? Okay, my personal view. Okay, so the question I got for this presentation today, there's of course some implications. I guess Fabien wanted me to talk about how we should combine different modalities. And why we should do that is pretty obvious, because different modalities pick up different brain signals, they have different strengths and weaknesses, and you can find this information in any textbook, so I would be done with my talk. Okay? But of course, there's an underlying question, which I assume is what drives all of us here. Okay, how could we better pick up relevant brain signals? So which brain signals are relevant for a particular application, and how could we do this? So I also try to talk about this with a focus on EEG hardware. And of course, why do we want to have better brain signal acquisition? Because we want to advance neurofeedback systems and applications. Okay, which I think is the most fundamental question here. And I hope there's no disagreement that we all share this goal here. Okay, so this will be the order of my presentation, the outline. I just flip the questions, start with advancing neurofeedback systems, and only in the end, after a detour covering most of my current research or some of my current research, I then share my thoughts on how to combine EEG and fMRI. I hope it's okay. Okay, so now I'll focus on EEG. Most of us, we are using EEG neurofeedback or EEG real-time applications because it's pretty non-invasive, low-cost portable hardware, and has excellent temporal resolution. But of course, we shouldn't forget about all the drawbacks, and there are plenty. For instance, it takes quite some skill to set up traditional EEG systems, at least. In general, the quality is relatively lousy in non-stationary mobile conditions, big problem for many, if not all, neuroimaging modalities. And of course, it's not really fun to wear the hardware for prolonged periods of time. And this, of course, all those problems we have to solve before we can even think about combining an EEG system with a hearing aid. So we need much better EEG technology than what is available right now. We don't have it, but at least we have a vision. Okay, so we have a goal. We call our vision the transparent EEG. So we want to have hardware that is perceptually transparent, so that would not interfere with me interacting with you like a pair of glasses, and if anything, it would even enhance our interaction, and would not distract you or me. Okay. So what are the features of such a system? First, it needs to be portable and motion tolerant. This is what currently sails under the flag mobile EEG, but this is not enough. Okay. So mobile EEG is not enough. So we also need to have really small and wireless hardware, and therefore there's no way avoiding the smartphone. So who here is not using a smartphone? Hands up, please. See? Okay, so you have the computer in your pockets. It's a very powerful one, and I'm very happy to see that now quite some startups pick up smartphone EEG. And within a very few years, we will all do this, I'm pretty certain. Okay, and then this is also not good enough. We also need what we call unobtrusive EEG acquisition, so you really need to forget about wearing the sensors, for instance, okay? And this is possible with ear EEG solutions we and other groups are developing. So I will very quickly cover some of our research on those fields. Now with mobile EEG, we, like many other groups, initially started with looking into consumer systems, but when you really kind of test them seriously, you figure out quite quickly that the signal quality you get from consumer systems like this one are pretty poor, modest at best. Okay? But they can be hacked, reverse engineered if you wish, combined with lab standard electrodes, for instance, and out of this comes a really nice, powerful EEG system that allows you to collect high-quality event-related potentials in free outdoors walking conditions. Actually, I'm not the first person doing a mobile EEG auditory oddball. The first person is Fabien, who published a nice paper, but this was an indoors free walking paper, and we did this outdoors. Okay, and what we see, so here you see event-related potentials. I hope you're familiar with this. So auditory evoked potentials followed by a P300, like the most frequently used brain feature for driving brain-computer interfaces. And we can see in one condition, this is the indoor seated condition, that we have a pretty nice P300 signal. And in the outdoors walking condition, we have like a reduction in amplitude that is roughly 30%. And this finding we could replicate a couple of times. So this brain signal basically indicates the relevance of a stimulus to a user. Okay, so if something is not relevant to you or not salient, you will not generate a P300. And if I manipulate your attention, say by a financial reward, then the P300 will scale in amplitude. Okay, so we could replicate this finding a couple of times, and we could also confirm that this was not due to completely different noise levels. So engineering-wise, of course, we look at the signal-to-noise ratio. And here's the signal-to-noise ratio now for the seated and the walking condition in just another replication study, and it was very similar. So what is driving the reduction in amplitude is basically the cognitive demand of free walking. Okay, when you freely walk on campus, usually we do this on campus, then of course you have to check the ground, you have to navigate a little bit, there's some distraction going on, and this all draws on the cognitive resources you would otherwise contribute to the primary task, the outdoor task. So this alone is very interesting because you could make use of this setup for various applications. Okay, so then we moved on to free walking using a slightly different hardware. And here we wanted to check whether we can confirm common brain signals in free walking conditions. So here the subject had to press buttons on a smartphone every now and then, and we wanted to see whether we can see the so-called readiness potential. So it's a negativity preceding voluntary actions. And this is what we find. So here we get this like preceding the button press negativity over contralateral sides. You can see that the quality is quite nice, so the maps look really nice and good. And the signal is very similar to a seated control condition. Well, this finding we never published, simply because it takes quite a while to clean up the data. And this is, of course, not what we want, in particular for real-time applications. And therefore, more recently, we switched to trying to support, validate, contribute online EEG artifact correction efforts. So here's a real-time artifact correction procedure called artifact subspace reconstruction, developed in different labs. Okay, so yeah, I'm generating a few artifacts. And I'm very good at generating artifacts, I can tell you. And now I switch to the real-time correction, so you can see that most of the iblinks are gone. Okay, shaking, most of the signal is gone. There's some residual movement artifact, but it's gross movement already, so this is not too bad. Because this could be applied, say, for a real-time VCI or neurofeedback session. Okay, but it's of course not perfect, and I don't want to claim that it's perfect. All I want to do is I want to share with you how much work it is to develop artifact correction properly. Okay, because what you have to do is you always have to look into how sensitive this procedure is in attenuating various artifacts. Here I'm highlighting only one, iblinks. So we look into how well a procedure, whatever that might be, can attenuate a well-known artifact. Okay. This is what we find here, and in our particular application, we always have to do this in indoors stationary as well as in outdoors mobile conditions, because many artifacts are even more problematic outdoors, of course. Okay, so we call this like the sensitivity of a procedure in attenuating artifacts, but that's not all of it. It's easy to attenuate completely artifacts, but you also attenuate the brain signal, so that wouldn't help much. You also have to look at specificity. Okay. How well do you preserve brain signals of interest? In our case, here we were looking at visually evoked potentials, how well they would survive the artifact correction procedure. Okay, and this is of course a very challenging situation because often we don't even know the artifact for sure and we don't even know the brain signal for sure. In my personal opinion, there's no artifact-free EEG. So every single sample, you can be certain that to some extent you also collect some non-brain signals. And in many instances, they might actually dominate the signal. And therefore, we have to explore and find new ways on learning better, okay, how to disentangle both and identify both. So recently, we started collaborating with a guy who is big in sonification. So here we are sonifying motion sensors put on the feet. This is the red and the blue trails. And some feature from the EEG, it's a red trace. Fun, right? So this is a jumping Oldenburg team. Okay. So we do this because we need to learn more about artifacts and we need to learn more about brain signals, and therefore we include into EEG motion sensors, so stream motion sensors along with EEG signals, and they could for instance be sonified to learn more about the association. Thereby for instance also help in improving artifact correction procedures. Okay, so the second, yeah.
It's okay to interrupt you, right?
Sure. Yeah.
So I was wondering, you just mentioned that you believe that there's basically always artifacts in EEG signals, and all these nice methods like ASR and other variants, they usually need a calibration period with artifact-free signals. So does that mean that we cannot do that? We need to find other ways to calibrate these methods to... How can we identify these artifacts if they are always here?
Nobody knows because nobody knows the ground truth.
Yeah.
And the reason, and the only support I have for my claim is that all electrical sources in your body always, or some of them, like your heart, always contribute something. And usually this is orders of magnitude larger than EEG, and it volume conducts everywhere. And therefore, very likely, even if you cannot see it in your data, it's nevertheless there. And then you could like try to optimize, say, a spatial filter procedure or a particular feature you can really relate to the source and try to sonify, for instance, it or somehow display it in another way that is perceivable to you, and then go along and test your different artifact correction procedures. That would be one way of doing this. But we haven't done it yet, so it's very early days. But you could basically use sonification either for conveying, for communication of very well-known features, alpha, say, or you could use it in a data mining way, where you try to kind of map as many different features as possible on sound. And this also is a high-dimensional room, as this demonstration illustrates. And then see whether, because your hearing system is has been developed to identify auditory objects, so coherence, feature, dynamics, and sound. And maybe you can recognize things you wouldn't recognize on a visual display. That's the idea.
So I don't understand very well the sonification procedure. Do you run an independent component analysis, principal component, something like that, to group the signals by sources and then convert those groups into a particular sound and mix it again, or does it come naturally? Could you explain that a little bit more?
That would be possible, but all the framework we are currently working on applies to real-time processing. So basically you take a stream that could be a motion sensor stream or any stream that is in the network, you pick it up, then translate it into open sound control messages, for instance, send it into an audio engine, and thereby you map a feature of interest that could be power, could be a time domain feature, map it into any audio dimension you may like, volume, pitch, harmonicity,
thanks,
whatever. But here it's only like the offline illustration, but the framework works online and it's very powerful, so you can do the same thing with completely different sensors, different EEG machines, we want to have it like universally working in Fusion. And the audio synthesis software, they are of course designed for real-time purposes, so they're very quick, very low latency tools are available. Okay, second topic would be smartphone EEG. Okay, so the company we are working with, we have been working for many years on developing better Android EEG acquisition features. And the current version we just received a few days ago allows to collect 24 channels of EEG, 24 channels of corrected, real-time corrected EEG. So you can really kind of have both at the same time. Then for every single channel, we can have the online impedance. So for every single channel, every single sample, we also get an estimate of impedance, which is nice. And then we have motion sensors, for instance, gyroscope on the head tracking. We can then have all the sensors from the smartphone also included, like GPS, accelerometers, and very recently also the camera of the smartphone, which is very nice because all this comes time synchronized, so you don't have to worry about how to bring together the different streams. So the online artifact correction on Android, this is only a screenshot from the very first recording, so I really don't know how good it is, but you should see a bright blue and a dark blue line for every channel, a couple of eye blinks in the uncorrected data, and a strong attenuation of the eye blink in the corrected data. Do you see what I want you to see? Kind of? Yeah, sorry, poor slide. This is what we are working on. The current delay is 4 seconds, and I hope we can also reduce the delay. Processing delay, of course, should be minimal. What is our idea for smartphone EEG? We have started developing a multi-application framework where the different applications communicate with well-defined protocols, TCP, UDP, and so on. Okay, and thereby, it's possible to integrate commercial and non-commercial developments. And you don't have to reinvent the wheel by, say, writing an application that would do all the signal acquisition and the signal display because it's available already, if there are interfaces established that allow you to interact with other software. So currently, we use one application for the data acquisition, and now the online artifact correction, another for implementing protocols. So that's a general purpose programming language, commercial unfortunately, but performs very well on Android. So you can run the very same experiments in your lab on Windows and on Android, performing very well. And then our own signal processing application talking basically to both applications. So we can use one for conveying feedback, whether they were kind of listening correctly to the streamer wanted them to listen to, for instance. And the other one would be used to extract like some snippets of data and do some processing on it. Okay. One recent study has nothing to do with current neurofeedback applications, but maybe with find the future feedback applications. So I have one student, and she convinced me to look into episodic memory. Our general idea with the hearing aid application, for instance, is of course that we want to measure brain activity in natural settings. If you cannot achieve this, then of course all those hearing aid and many other applications are not feasible. But if you could achieve this, then maybe there's some application of this technology in completely different domains, like boosting your memory. That would be cool, right? If we had like a memory booster BCI or neurofeedback system. So the idea would be that while an item is presented, the brain activity is being analyzed, and one would try to guess whether you are going to remember this item, yes or no. This is a so-called subsequent memory effect. So we give you a list of items, and after some time, half an hour or so, you have to recall all the items you are learning, right? And when you do this and you contrast all the items that were later remembered to those that were forgotten, there's a very clear difference in your brain activity. If you could get this online on a single trial level, You could think about a closed loop system that would repeat the same item again or alert you saying, well, you are not really attending, okay? You want to do this trial again because I know that you're never going to remember this anyway, okay? Waste of time. Wouldn't that be cool? Well, we don't have it, but what we want is we want to drive this memory system properly. And the episodic memory system is defined by combining what, where, and when information. Think about some important event in your life, say graduation party, first time you kissed someone, or you know, whatever. Okay? I'm pretty certain that you also remember the location, right? That comes for free because it was encoded together during the event. So this is a one-shot, your brain is a one-shot learning system. It's pretty cool. So things experienced once may be remembered for the rest of your life. Isn't that cool? Kind of. I love it. If it was working for me, so well. Here we were using now mobile EEG, smartphone EEG, to try to make use of the where information, the location information. If you do this in the lab, it works fine, but we do not really exploit episodic memory because the spatial context is completely missing. It's absent. Okay, so therefore we go out of the lab for asking our students to learn items. So this all runs on smartphone, so all the experiments are controlled on smartphone, the EEG acquisition is controlled on smartphone, the experimenter brings the participant to particular locations, then the participant initiates a trial by a button press, then some item is presented and they're supposed to encode, memorize this item and the location. Okay, and then they walk to the second location and so on. Not known to the participants, some locations were rich in spatial features, like this one. We call this a landmark location, and others were like were absent of rich features, so in the middle of something. Okay. And then we were hoping to see a difference in the memory performance depending on how rich the spatial context was. So we did this with smartphone EEG and GPS tracking so we could also control what they were doing in a second recall. So after a learning block, they are being walked back to the lab and then they have to just recall, write down all the words they remember. And after this first recall, they do a second recall, then we tell them, okay, now bring us to all the locations you remember, okay, and tell us a word. And so we have like two different recalls, so we can look into the location recall performance and the word location performance and the combination of both. And the EEG results are pretty cool. We see, for instance, an increased theta response during the item encoding for the later remembered items, and we also see very nice event-related potentials. For the sake of time, I skip the results because this is published, so feel free to look at the paper. Okay, but it should give you some idea on what we currently can do with smartphone EEG. Okay, and the last part where we put most effort into is into developing unobtrusive EEG acquisition. Technologies, after failing with all sorts of different devices, we ended up with a product that is now available for purchase. And I can advertise this because I don't make any money with this, so I'm completely independent. And there's no patent or anything, so you can improve it, modify it if you wish, or fine. All the information is available on the website. So it's a flex-printed sensor array that fits around the ear. So 10 electrodes, silver printed, and they take a little bit of gel, so it's a wet electrode, and you just put it on, and if you know how to put them on, this is a procedure taking definitely less than 1 minute, and then you can collect, or hook it up to any EEG amplifier you like, wireless or wired, doesn't matter, and then you can collect brain signals. So what do you see? You see, of course, alpha activity when subjects close their eyes. When you run auditory oddball studies, you see a very nice P300 event-related potential. So same thing I just reported a few minutes ago on the cap we can get from the ear. And a huge advantage compared to the cap is that with this sensor array, first of all, many subjects forget about wearing it, which is nice. And second, we can have impedance over many, many, many hours. Okay, so it's good enough for sleep EEG easily. So here, for instance, we hook up the participant late in the evening, 9 p.m., and he wakes up like after 6 in the morning, and you can see here the impedance of most channels is pretty low and continuous. So we often see that roughly 2 hours it takes impedance to settle to the lowest level, just the time it takes fluid gels to interact with the skin. And then because it's a sealed electrode, like clinical EEG electrodes, there's no drying of the gel or anything. So pretty nice signal quality-wise. So interim conclusions here on this advancing neurofeedback systems that I really believe in unobtrusive long-term EEG acquisition. And that, of course, benefits from the smartphone you have in your pocket. Currently, the ear EEG solution works pretty well. Maybe long-term recording is also possible with headphone EEG applications. There are a couple of companies presenting this year, and several developments are going on. And I hope that by this technology maturing further over the next few months and years, we can somehow complement the hugely growing, exploding mHealth market with proper physiology. Okay, that would be nice, and neurophysiology in particular.
So this flexible technology of the electrodes around the ear, it looks particularly interesting if you want to measure, for instance, EEG activity around the hippocampus, amygdala, inferior temporal lobe region. Kind of interesting for memory. So it sort of like jumps back to me the previous experiment that you just presented with people walking around in the campus and trying to make associative memory. Yeah.
Can I please postpone your question because it's a very important one and I'll come to this exactly.
So
the question is what exactly do we measure with this kind of weird EEG? Okay, and it's a very important question. Okay, and that brings me to my next topic. Okay, so the question behind this, okay, is how should we acquire EEG, and that also relates to what kind of information we get from EEG. Now, how should we do this? So here is my example. So let's focus on the electrooculogram we are all familiar with. So in the traditional way, and many neurofeedback systems also have this, so you have like a reference channel for monitoring artifacts, like a vertical EEG channel for monitoring eye blinks, and a horizontal one for monitoring gaze, right? Okay. Now, when you compare those two channels, so one is like the blue one, the other one is the red one. Okay. When you compare those channels, then of course you see on the vertical EEG channel the eye blink, but you hardly see the lateral eye movement. And on the horizontal EEG channel, you very nicely see the gaze to the left and right, but you hardly see the eye blink. Why is that? Even though the generator of the activity sits just between your electrodes, perfect. Now the reason is, of course, the orientation of the generator. And this is exactly my answer to your question. So we need to be aware of the generator orientation, not only the location. So location is overemphasized. We make a major mistake by thinking that by putting an electrode over frontal central areas, we pick up prefrontal cortex activity. Very likely wrong. So when you look up publications looking for standardization, and of course standardization of protocols is very important, I agree, okay, with the previous speakers. But I'm not too happy about what exactly they're recommending. Simply because, assume we have a particular Brodmann area that is very important for a particular neurofeedback application. Let's assume we knew exactly where it was, okay? Let's assume we would put an electrode as close as possible to this area. Now, when you compare different brains, from different individuals, there is of course different gyrification. So even if the location, the 3D coordinate, would be exactly the same, and even if it was only one generator and there was no noise, nothing, for sure, between our brains, the orientation of the generator would be different, and this results in completely different topographies. This cannot be the way to go.
My own field is fMRI and MRI, and localization for us is quite critical.
Yeah.
And because we have the possibility to actually localize the anatomy much better,
we
tend to forget.
Yeah, we can also learn from the fMRI community. I fully agree. So functional localizers are very common. They're often very useful, not always, but often. Okay, we don't do this in EEG. And of course, I'm not saying that you should like explore your data and find the channel where there is a significance. We have to also learn from the engineering people. And the machine learning field, of course, you know, very clearly tells that we have to validate what we are doing. Sure. And that the same thing holds for EEG analysis. Okay? So you could have independent data picking a channel and then going with this channel into your training. Very likely you would get a better system performance compared to a pre-standardized setup, very likely. Here I show one study where we look into this. So here, a subject did a kinesthetic motor imagery task, and then we analyze sensory motor rhythms and the beta, so 8 to 30 hertz sensory motor areas, using spatial filters like traditionally well-established in the field, nothing new, using Fabian's great software, wonderful open source development, I can really recommend. And we do this initially with high-density EEG, 96, 128 channels, whatever. And then we wanted to see whether we could somehow identify the most crucial channels and go into a training, 3 days training program with only those channels. So overnight, for every single participant, we made a new cap. Okay, and this new cap had only one bipolar channel per hemisphere, or actually two. One for one algorithm and another one recommended by another algorithm. And then we wanted to compare which algorithm was performing better and whether this would be feasible at all. And we wanted to see what the consistency of the recommended channel was between individuals. And this is what we are showing here. So there are two individuals and the group data, bottom row. And two different spatial filters procedures, ignore them, doesn't matter right now. Okay, so one on the left, that's a supervised, and on the right is an unsupervised procedure. And now, here those lines show which electrodes would be identified as the most informative channel. Okay, now when you look plot the density, how frequently every single channel was selected for a sample of 20 or so individuals, then you can see that for the CSP, you find exactly the channels C3, C4, which you would use based on the literature, okay? Exactly, so. But of course, there's some variance. So this channel was selected by quite a few, but far from all individuals, okay? And then the other algorithm would recommend something different, but nevertheless, then you can compare the performance, right? How good is the performance on a single bipolar channel compared to all the channels? And when you do this, you find that the standard pair, C3, C4, performs the worst. It's above chance, but it's not really good. All electrodes online performs the best, also not surprising. And the CSP-derived bipolar pair performs pretty well. And if you add only very few electrodes, you already have competitive level of performance of the system. So a few electrodes can be sufficient. But again, that doesn't mean that a few electrodes are sufficient for everyone. You have to really individualize the number of electrodes as well, not only the location, but also the number of electrodes. We did this offline, so we took our high-density 96-channel EEG, and then every line is one individual, and then we iterate down from 96 to two or so channels, and always remove the least helpful electrode. The least informative electrode goes out, the system is trained again, we do this again, out comes a line for every subject. And on average, we see that the usual recommendation in the BCI field for motor imagery takes some 20-ish channels, you are fine, is correct. This is like we are here, roughly, and there's not too much we learn from adding more channels. But look at the huge individual differences. There are quite a few individuals that perform perfectly well with two electrodes or two channels. It just, you know, it's a waste of time to spend more electrodes. Just not needed. Then we have maybe the true illiterates. I come to illiteracy in a minute. Okay, so they, you can throw another, you know, 500 electrodes on them, and they will not really produce any proper system performance. Okay, but you have also a few subjects that really benefit from going from lower to higher density. So here, for the sake of time, for a training regime, of course, you need to have a very efficient system. For the sake of time, of course, what we recommend is to have like a first evaluation session in the lab, trying to optimize a system for every single individual, and that can be a very sparse EEG, and then go with this one. And in some other cases, you know, when you go with the sparse, because you only have sparse, or because, then very likely that will give you bad performance. And then you simply don't know whether it's just not enough information for this individual, or whether it's an individual, or what is really going on here. Okay, so to conclude this part, so I really believe that individualized spatial filters are beneficial. This is very well known in the BCI field, nothing new, okay? And this is really important for low density setups. A bipolar channel is a spatial filter as well. So it has a very strong bias for picking up brain sources from different areas and different orientations. Okay, so spatial filter not only like the advanced signal processing. So, and taking this serious means you really have to consider a pre-training evaluation session. And that brings me finally to the last point of combining different modalities. Because here, fMRI can be very, very useful. So there are, of course, a couple of implicit assumptions when you combine or when you consider combining different modalities like EEG and fMRI. And one assumption is, of course, what we call in psychology convergent validity. They both point to the same result. Okay? So we assume that an EEG signal and an fMRI signal, at least to some degree, reflects neural activity. Okay? And we know from many, many studies that they do not really measure the very same thing, hemodynamics and so on, blah. Okay, I don't have to tell you. Okay? But we assume, of course, that there's some degree of overlap, both for event-related and for ongoing or non-event-related designs. We just don't know how large the overlap is. If there was no overlap whatsoever, then, of course, we wouldn't learn anything from combining EEG and fMRI. And very often, this is the problem in many studies. Sometimes, for many reasons, you know, we find this and that, but very little correlation between both, and then it's getting really problematic. So what is driving the overlap between both? That really depends. So many years ago, we proposed doing a simultaneous EEG fMRI simply because we learned very quickly that the overlap can be really small if you do not really put the subject into the same recording environment. So in a sitting or supine position, recording EEG is really different and can affect your ongoing EEG. The scanner noise cannot be replicated exactly outside the scanner. It's just not possible. You can replay, of course, you know, sequences, but it sounds quite different. So it's very hard to come even close to that. So to the extent that you believe that your brain signal of interest is somehow influenced by sensory processing, you really have to do simultaneous recordings, because only this would allow you to kind of increase the overlap. If, however, you need to optimize your signal quality anyway, you better go do a separate recordings, because there's plenty of artifact coming in from the MRI environment, and it's very, very challenging to get rid of this. There's fortunately not too much damage the EEG setup contributes to the fMRI signal, but this definitely needs to be considered. So it really depends on the purpose. Now I present, to the end of my talk, I present two examples, one doing simultaneous EEG fMRI and the other one doing a separate EEG fMRI, hoping to convey the message that both approaches are really, really useful. Okay, one was this an EEG motor imagery study, neurofeedback study, during fMRI. So we did the kinesthetic motor imagery inside the fMRI while collecting the fMRI data and giving the real-time EEG feedback. That, of course, requires cleaning up the artifacts from the incoming EEG, challenge, big challenge, extracting the feature, and then conveying the feedback, usually visual bar, to the subject while the subject is in the scanner. And that would allow you to evaluate whether your EEG feedback has any impact on the brain activity as measured with a second modality, with fMRI. Huge benefit compared to one modality only. So here we show the event-related desynchronization of the online corrected EEG data recorded inside 3 Tesla fMRI. And what we want to see always is a larger desynchronization over the contralateral compared to the ipsilateral hemisphere. So usual tasks are like, you know, imagined hand opening, closing, or some finger tapping procedure. Okay, so this is what we see here. So that's a cue. This is a go signal in the signaling left or right hand. And then we combine left, right hand into contra ipsilateral. You see this dip. Quite nice. Now, for the offline corrected data, after doing this, of course, we evaluate the data again because online artifact correction can never be as good as offline artifact correction. And the BCI field learned this quite nicely, and it's now standard to really offline consider all your data again, not just go with the online result. And then, of course, we can do a little bit better and get like a larger difference and overall a little bit larger brain response. And then, of course, we have an offline because we don't trust our own recordings very much for EEG fMRI. That's really tricky. We, of course, all often have an offline or an outside scanner control condition where a subject has to do in the traditional EEG environment the task again. And this is what you get here. So it looks very similar. The condition effect, the difference between blue and red, is a little bit larger, which is nice. And here we also get the beta rebound, which was absent in those studies. We don't know why. Maybe the artifact correction was taking high frequency activity, more of the beta out of the signal. But what is nice is that they all correlate quite nicely. So the online corrected data correlates to the offline corrected data. The online corrected data correlates to the outside collected data, and so on. Okay, so pretty good correlation across sessions or across processing modalities. So we can have some confidence in the results. And what is the main result for me? One main result is that when you compare the fMRI sessions without EEG feedback to the fMRI sessions with EEG feedback, then we get a nicer bold response for the concurrent EEG feedback. So EEG feedback helps in driving brain activity patterns in particular areas. Very nice. Okay, and of course we know from EEG, you know all this, that EEG feedback, if done properly, helps as well in driving some brain signals. Okay, this one just confirms what we all know, and this is a really nice added information. Now, with several modalities, you have some advantage because now you can address the problem of illiteracy again. And by correlating across subjects, now the performance in the EEG system to the performance in the fMRI system, we could look into whether there was any correlation. And you can see right away there's not much correlation going on. But there are different types, at least the qualitative clustering indicates different types of individuals. There's, of course, many individuals. They can do, they can generate very nice activity in the fMRI during motor imagery, and they do this in the EEG as well. So they have a very nice contralateral EID. This is like, I don't know, 50, 60% of the sample. Okay, this is the guys we want, right, for developing paradigms. Then we have quite a few. They perform perfectly well in the fMRI, but we get nothing out of the EEG. So they have completely screwed up EEG patterns, but they produce a mental task because they have this really nice, decent fMRI pattern. So we always contrast contra versus ipsilateral. And then we have maybe the true illiterates, if you want, even though I would be very careful here. They, in this session, neither in the EEG nor in the fMRI, they were producing the expected activity patterns. Okay, so whether we claim someone can or cannot use a neurofeedback or BCI system depends on the modality. And what I have not covered here should depend on a number of sessions. So there are some papers from other groups claiming that it takes 10, maybe 11 sessions before you can statistically make a claim about whether someone can or cannot learn. Okay, the very last part. I don't know, am I running out of time? Or? Okay. He can wait. Okay, so here we use fMRI for the pre-post evaluation, while the training was a home neurofeedback training with chronic stroke patients. Okay, so the movie illustrates the procedure. This is, of course, a student now. But basically, we take our mobile EEG home to the participants. We develop it such that the setup time is really, really short, 5, maybe maximum 10 minutes. Okay. And then we design a feedback that tries to follow Fabian's recommendations as good as possible. For instance, we don't give any negative feedback anymore, so the ball cannot go to the wrong side. And we have like a two-dimensional feedback. One drives only the contralateral hemisphere and the other one the symmetry. So even if you cannot do the task, you get some positive feedback if you are engaged in the task, okay, to start with. And patients can control whether the next try begins or not. So it can be very demanding to do mental imagery over a couple of trials, and many of those elderly patients, they need a break every now and then, and they can initiate the break themselves. Okay, so we try to kind of make it a bit more flexible. Okay, and what we find is, I jump over this. So we had three patients, and they were doing 14 sessions at home every second day, and one of them definitely improved. So it's like this was a stroke in the midbrain, brainstem stroke. And here we look into the corticospinal tract. We try to look into whether CST changes pre-post training. This is a lateralization for all the training sessions. Before training, there was this abnormal pattern of EID with more IPSI as compared to contra lateral brain activity. And this normalized after the training. Motivation was high with some fluctuations because our system was way too rigid. There was some family issue going on, and the person was not well ready for a neurofeedback session on this particular day. But because we had prefix every second day, we tried to be scientists, we tried to follow strictly the protocol, and that, of course, may not be always the most and the best approach. Okay, and when you compare pre and post, we also see pretty encouraging results on the fMRI level as well. So here also the some normalization takes place. So And there was, like, in the Fugl-Meyer, there was a significant improvement as well. This, of course, is not a claim that motor imagery helps in motor stroke rehabilitation, not at all. The only thing we can say from this is that our system seems to be robust enough and that it would be really nice to run a clinical trial to evaluate this more properly. So in summary, I really believe that high intensity, frequent practice is necessary to modify brain functions, in particular impaired brain functions. We cannot really expect a patient to benefit from 2, 3, 4 sessions. Not really, right? So we should try to take this into account. Most of the current recording modalities we have available, including most EEG systems, they are just not fit for this. Either they are too expensive. Nobody would fund a study where you do, say, 100 fMRI sessions on a patient. Okay, so this is a real problem. So we have to think about how to combine different modalities to somehow bypass those challenges. And of course, for EEG, EEG home training is really feasible, but of course, we need better systems that are user-friendly and so on. We are not developing systems. We only look at feasibility, if you wish. Okay, so this is not my job. But for some applications, I really hope that chronic EEG recorded in natural situations can be quite helpful. Think about a passive BCI system or drowsiness controlled systems. What does it help to somehow do some neurofeedback on drowsiness in lab conditions if this doesn't translate to daily life situations. So you definitely want to do this in work environments as well. Okay, and finally, smartphone EEG is upcoming, and I really hope, my big hope is that it would allow us to find really new fields of application for EEG, and in particular real-time EEG research. Okay, but of course we should never ignore the complexity of the problem, of the signal. Okay, so we need to be aware of spatial filters, even with single-channel EEG. Thank you.
I was wondering about the slide where you showed the responses in EEG training and in fMRI training, one of the last studies that you showed. It seemed that one of the quadrants was empty, so maybe that's well known, so it's a naive question, but that, does that mean that some people, that no people learn EEG, I mean, train the EEG response without training also the fMRI response?
Good question. I don't know. I usually assume that that maybe our signal processing is not good enough to extract the relevant information. It may well be the case that in many individuals where we claim that the EEG system doesn't work, maybe we do not dig hard enough, and maybe we don't have the high quality artifact correction tools that would allow us to extract those features. So Jeremy made a very important statement this morning saying that only because you don't find evidence, it's not evidence of no effect. Okay, it's very important. So I cannot really answer your question, but I would be very careful with claiming that someone cannot do something. It's very hard to prove. Does this relate to your question?
I'm not sure. can you show the slide? Is it possible?
Which one?
It's one of the latest studies where you compared the two modalities. Yeah, this one. You have almost no points in the quadrant in the left.
I'm not sure this is really representative, okay, because we would have to replicate this, and it was so terrible and complicated to set it up that we will not do this again. That's simple. So I don't know whether we have like a proper range of variance in both dimensions that would be needed to answer your question. So whether this is a truly empty spot, I don't know.
That was great. Thank you.